In fact, let me get a real estate industry voice on this as well. Niranjan Hiranandani, of course, part of the well-established Hiranandani group. He's also president of NAREDCO. Mr. Hiranandani, how significant is this going to be? 5% on under construction without input tax credit, 1% on affordable housing without input tax credit. Talk to us about how significant will this move be? How long away will it be in terms of alleviating some of the stress? And of course, differential rates still persist, rather no rate on ready to move in versus 5% on under construction. Will it at least narrow the gap in terms of the demand mismatch goes?
You're absolutely correct. It is definitely going to narrow the gap. But more than narrowing the gap, it's a customer perception which had gone totally haywire. A person just couldn't understand how it is possible to think of 12% GST on under construction and zero once the construction is over. Even if there was a reset in prices, the customer was not ready to look at the input tax credit component of the whole thing. So I think it's a wonderful move that it has been brought down to 5% in terms of the GST for under construction, and that and zero, of course, is still a gap. But overall, I think it's a definitely a way forward to be done. Number two, I think the recommendation which had originally gone was 2% for affordable housing, which has now come down to 1% for affordable housing. So I think the Prime Minister's focus on affordable housing seems to continue its way, both in the case of the budget, both in terms of other issues in terms of credit availability and also the interest subvention for affordable housing. The combination of that is sought to make the Housing for All project by 2022 a reality. So I think all these three things put together sounds good for the industry. And of course, there are various issues relating to cheaper housing in terms of it, and people say the benefit is not adequate enough because no input tax credit is there. There is a good argument to that story. But I think it's a fantastic beginning, and I think I'm pretty happy about the whole story.
In fact, I have a follow-up for you, Mr. Hiranandani, before I also go back to Ramesh Nair. What is the rate right now with input tax credit? What is the effective tax rate that it comes to? And then is it fair to understand that at 5% without input tax credit, the prices should actually go up in the short term? I mean, clarify that for us.
No, I don't think there is a fixity about that, because at different price levels, the input tax credit was different. So if you look at the high-priced properties in the city of Mumbai and stuff like that, definitely the benefit is clearly available. On the affordable segment, anyway, the affordable segment, the tax has been reduced to 1%. So I think across the board, the benefit is now available because you have divided the two. But where there is not an affordable thing, but the prices are low, there is still a doubt as to whether the full benefit will be available to the builder developer, because he is not getting input tax credit benefit. So some of the developers would crib about this story, and that has been talked about for quite a few days. But all in all, very good move.
Right. In fact, Ramesh Nair, clarify this for us as well. You are in discussion with the developers and consumers on a regular basis. Talk to us on this 5% rate without input tax credit. How significant will this be on the pricing scenario? And of course, will builders now have some kind of a leeway in terms of pushing the under construction houses, because they also need it for project funding, versus the ready to move in demand that, of course, has no GST?
Niranjan Bhai, I think, summarized it quite well. The perception amongst the home buyers was, if I am going to buy a project which is under construction, I'm going to be paying so much. So that had led to a lot of under construction projects suffering big time, where buyers were just not coming in. I think this at least clarified that perceptional change, that you can go ahead and buy under construction project. Not too many developers in the country today are financially sound enough, especially after the NBFC crisis, to complete a project and then wait for buyers to come. So on the heels of overall financial and liquidity crunch in the market, I think it's definitely a welcome move from the government side. And I think it's a great effort from the government side to show that they want this sector to do well. We all should remind ourselves that this sector contributes 8 to 9% of the overall Indian GDP and is the second largest employer, the real estate and construction sector after agriculture. So it's quite good for the overall sector.
Mr. Hiranandani, a couple of clarifications needed from you here, because there was a view in the market that the differential tax structure should go away. So while affordable housing, of course, will have differential tax rates, but the differential in between, you know, zero tax for ready to move in versus some tax on under construction is really harming the industry in certain way. Two questions here. Of course, will this 5% be able to at least get you to push more under construction houses out of the way? Or considering that there's still a huge inventory of ready to move in houses, this cut isn't really going to do much in the near term at least?
No, I think basically we would have been extremely happy if all GST would have been zero and everything would have been focused on the cases of stamp duty. But that would not help the central government, because the sharing would go to entirely to the states through the stamp duty rationalization. So there was a talk relating to that, but I don't think that has been accepted at all. On the issue of whether the GST should be levied under construction, there has been a controversy for the last 10 to 15 years that real estate construction is an immovable property, and in reality, it's not a good and goods and services. So it should be treated as immovable property, and hence GST should be zero. But the high courts in the case of Karnataka set a precedent saying that no under construction property can be levied service and VAT, and service tax should be levied, and hence when GST came into the picture, there was there. So this difference will continue unless the government thinks of rationalizing the government is willing to forego its share of it so that everything will go to the states. So it's a matter of center and state revenue share rather than just the constructor. But I think this first rationalization is definitely helpful. And the second part is, you must remember that the government has not yet reduced the GST on cement, which was expected. So I think that is a big thing which the central government is still getting, and they will not allow any set-off now. So cement GST is certainly a negative part of it. It was expected, but that has not come along with this, because they're not getting the input tax credit and GST and cement continues. So in a way, relations with the central government will continue to be high.
Absolutely. In fact, Rohit Jain, what's your take on this issue? While, yes, it is a sentimental positive and it is going to have some impact, the other issues are still not addressed, and beyond some kind of a short-term uptick, maybe this is not going to have that big a move and impact. What's your view?
No, I don't think so. It's a short-term, it's a long-term. I think this would have a big impact in the market and the mindset of the home buyers. As rightly being said by Mr. Hiranandani, that here the prices is because of the higher the land cost, and land anyway not liable to GST, and there is no question of a credit. If the value of the flat goes up significantly, it is on account of the land, and construction cost more or less remains in the same range. If that be the case, what the developers will be losing in only a small portion of an input tax credit, and therefore output tax going down from 12% to 5%, and that's a 7% impact under construction vis-a-vis the post-construction, or even today, the 12% and 5%, where 7% reduction in the tax cost is definitely a big move. Because keep in mind, today you pay 12% GST, you pay 6% of a stamp duty, so 18% tax cost on a high-value flat is definitely a dampener. And more importantly, real estate sector, according to me, has been facing challenges for last 3 years. 2016, we had demonetization. 2017, we had GST. 2018, we had NBFC crisis. And therefore, real estate sector is anyway in doldrum. And this is an important move, that now the under construction flats will start getting sold, and the liquidity and all other aspects will definitely boost the sector. This was much needed, according to me.
Absolutely. In fact, I'm going to take this question to both Ramesh Nair and Mr. Hiranandani as well. Ramesh Nair, if you just see what's happened in the last couple of months, starting with the budget announcement, and before that also there were SOPs that were put in place for affordable housing. But with the budget, whether you are reinvesting money into property or whether it's the rent deferral on the second houses, combined with the rate cut that came in recently and now with the GST cut, how far, you know, will a combination of these factors go in alleviating the stress that's been faced by the real estate industry, as Rohitjan highlighted, in the past few years, and going forward as well, in terms of reducing the funding gap, in terms of reducing the liquidity squeeze, in terms of clearing away inventory? How significant will all of these moves combined be for the sector?
See, the big worry has been the NBFC crisis over the last 3 to 4 months. There's hardly any liquidity in the system. A lot of developers today who are totally relying on the NBFCs as a source of funds are truly suffering today. And NBFCs were depending on mutual funds, that flow is just stopped. We believe this year the overall supply situation across the country is going to kind of come down, mainly driven by this. Although demand will pick up thanks to measures like what's just been done, but the overall supply situation will come down because even some of the biggest developers in the country today are going through a huge amount of financial stress.
In fact, Mr. Hiranandani, this is a question for you as well. You know, established developers such as yourself have been able to tide through the crisis in some sort of way, but the entire sector, and you speak from an industry body representative as well, has been facing this liquidity crunch, has been facing this funding crunch, has been facing this issue of unsold inventory. How serious is the stress right now? How big an impact has it been? And like I asked Ramesh Nair as well, the combination of the budget, the rate cut, and of course with the GST cut coming in, how significant will it be to alleviate the industry stress?
First of all, let me explain to you that what has happened to the industry is a tsunami. The combination of the four segments which have hit us in the last 1-2 years, industry has definitely gone through a huge crisis. So what is now happening is there's a step-by-step alleviation, which I think Mr. Nair just mentioned. And I think it will definitely improve. Things will become better and better. But the hurt and damage is not going to be rectified overnight. But yes, the answer is yes, it is definitely going to improve. A lot of people on the marginal side will improve faster, and other people will take more time for it to improve. But the whole thing is in the right direction. Number two, there is an objective of the Prime Minister and the government, which talks about affordable housing in a very big way. Remember, the entire focus, all the changes which have been taken, giving it infrastructure status, improving the loan availability, allowing a 90% loan for the purposes of affordable housing, interest rates coming down, giving interest subvention, all these are definitely going to be helping the industry. As far as the individual builders are concerned, which is what you're asking me, the answer is the improvement shall take place. Only thing is that it will not happen overnight. It can't happen. A destruction in the industry will take some time to rectify itself, but it is happening and it will happen. And this is another step towards that direction. So I think it's very positive. I'm extremely happy with the moves which the government has made, and really compliment the government to understand the problems of the industry and more so the perception of the consumer. The consumer's perception is extremely important, and I think this move certainly addresses that aspect. 12% was a no, and 5% sounds reasonable, though 1% is fantastic and 0 would have been excellent.
Right, you've clearly put your views on that. I'm not sure if the government is going to agree to further rate cuts, at least on under construction, but we'll have to wait and see if cement GST is cut, and that could definitely be another fillip for the industry. Rohitjan, the affordable housing question, 90 square meters, that's the limit that's been set for affordable housing, 1% GST over there. Give us a sense on two questions. Where does it stand right now as far as the government's affordable housing push goes? What kind of success, or I wouldn't say success, but what kind of penetration has been achieved in terms of getting demand going for that and getting developers interested in affordable housing? And this 1% rate now coming in, more SOPs that were announced on budget with regards to interest subvention as well. How significant will this be for the affordable housing push?
Yeah, so let me just take up your last question first. Existingly, under the current regime, GST on affordable housing is 8%. So currently, whenever somebody buys a house of, to say, 30 lakhs, 40 lakhs rupees, which is now considered to be an affordable housing infrastructure status, you pay 8% GST. That is going down by 7%. It's straight to 1%. It's definitely a big move, because that is how the push will be given to this particular sector. But mind you that even today, affordable housing, when they pay 8% tax, they typically also incur huge cost on GST being paid on the construction, which is available to them as a credit today. On that 1% scheme, that credit won't be available to them. And if you look at it, an affordable housing as a project, it is not a big in the land cost. It is mainly a 50-60% also is a construction cost, and 20-30-40% in the range of that is a land cost. So therefore, the not availability of a credit will have some impact on the cost escalation and the prices will go up. But in an overall scheme of things, the affordable housing tax burden overall, considering the loss of input tax credit plus the reduction in the output tax, will have some saving on an overall scheme. And this will definitely help the sector. Coming to your first question, how this has been penetrated in the market today and how the push has been the government on this. Government, of course, under the PMAY scheme and even otherwise, has been pushing in relation to this sector very well. We have seen so many houses have been constructed, but more importantly...
Rohit, I'll just come back to you. My apologies. Sushil Modi, Bihar Deputy Chief Minister speaking. Let's cut across to him.
This is another GST Council. And a lot of this discussion is going on. 1 April.
First April.
Right. We couldn't get too many details out of that. We'll try and see if we can pick up more. But Rohit, continue with the point you were making.
Yeah. So affordable housing, I think still a lot to be done. If you see in terms of the push by the industry, they have been trying to push and giving the sector and getting their interest in this sector. We have seen a lot of big projects have been launched, even in cities like Mumbai nearby area, like Thane and beyond, and Pune and other places. But it still needs a significant push. PMAY scheme, where they have come out with the triple P as a scheme, but I don't think so that has interested by a lot of developers. So PMAY, CLSS, subvention scheme are the most popular scheme in the affordable sector, which has been getting some interest. But I think still a lot of things yet to be done. And I feel that this 1% GST will help. In fact, more importantly, the budget-related provisions, some of that you invest in the second house, you will get the exemption or you are still entitled for the capital gain relief. All of these will also help the sector. In all, February month as a whole has to be a celebrated month by the developer, because the 1st February, a lot of announcement on the real estate sector, and again this month again we are seeing the GST rate going down.
Point taken, Rohit. Let me come down to my final questions to our experts then. Ramesh Nair, I come back to the inventory question, and please feel free to share the data that you have on this as well. The last I pick up, 6.73 lakh units in 7 cities remain unsold, and within that a large portion is also ready to move in flats. Talk to us about clearing this inventory going forward. What's going to be the thought process of the industry as it adjusts to these changes that have come in?
When any number is mentioned in terms of under construction inventory, it's always whenever the number under construction unsold is mentioned, we need to stay focused on the word under construction, because typically a real estate project in the country takes 3 years, and whatever stock is available in a good market can be absorbed in 3 years. So nothing much to be alarmed about. If you look at the overall demand, at least in the top 7 cities, with these kind of measures, I'm sure the 140,000 units which are sold in the top 7 cities can easily become 200,000 units. And with 200,000 units, you just look at a 3-year sale, and there goes your 600,000 under construction. The demand for affordable housing, which is true affordable, what India needs, that's a 10 lakh units 10 million units per annum demand. We're talking of if developers can build, then they can sell 1 crore units a year, and that 1 crore can be broken up. That potential demand can be broken up based on what the population growth contributing to around 3.5 million of the 10 million, nuclearization of various families that can absorb around 2.5 million. And rising income and aspirations again contributed to around 4 million units. But for the government's affordable housing dream to come true, obviously the government has to work proactively to become a supplier of land and a supplier of approvals. They need to kind of unlock the land potential, need to create single window, fast track approvals. The government has done a single tax regime for entire India. Why can't they do a single approval scheme for developments across India? Obviously, today, the various figures which come, which shows that close to when you buy a house, nearly 38% of that goes in taxes, 27% from the developer side and 11% as a buyer. If the government can bring that down, that definitely gives an impetus to affordable housing. Things like rental schemes need to be incentivized. Financing still is available, but for the real people who need affordable housing, financing is still a challenge. And the banking system opening up loans for land will also help the affordable housing sector. So these are the things required if you need to kind of make sure this leads. And for the sector to grow, what we have seen in most emerging markets, therefore housing sector needs to do well. So the government is really looking at growing at that 7-8%. The housing sector needs to do well, and it cannot be ignored. And good job by the government from the budget and today's announcement to having shown that they like the sector.
Point taken, Ramesh. Mr. Hiranandani, final word to you, sir. What next? These many measures put in place, what do you want next?
Basically, there's one big gap which has remained in the whole policy of housing for all and all the other policies which have declared, and Ramesh Nair has just hinted at it. Even in the richest country, America, 50% of the people live in rental housing. And today we have nothing at all in terms of the housing policy, both housing for all or the Prime Minister's PMAY scheme or in the schemes which have come up to give a boost to housing. What do you expect? That every man on the street will own a house? That's really physically, mentally, financially, economically not possible and not real. So you needed to give a boost not only for housing for all or affordable housing for all, but affordable housing on rent or ownership. I think somehow that seems to be missing, and we are pushing those thoughts and ideas. It's still not brought on. And unless that doesn't come in, I think we will not be really fulfilling the aspirations of the people of India. You just can't do it without rental housing. And I think that needs to be the next step which the government needs to do. And also, we are very grateful that the Reserve Bank of India is also improving the liquidity position both with the NBFCs and the banks for the purpose of lending. We also need to get one rollover, as was happened after the Lehman crisis in October 2008, and they are asking that the Reserve Bank of India should really look at this and give one rollover as they did 2008 to today because of the situation of these multiple tsunamis which have happened. So I think these two things we need very quickly.
Absolutely, Mr. Hiranandani. Thanks so much for joining in today, gentlemen. Mr. Hiranandani, Ramesh Nair, Chairman JLL, and of course, Rohit Jain, Economic Law Practice, for putting this big news in perspective for us. Let's also hear out a couple of voices from that meeting. Sushil Kumar Modi, as well as CP Singh, who is the Urban Development Minister for Jharkhand.
Affordable housing, 1% for non-affordable housing, 5% both without ITC, and a capping of 45 lakh. And for the metro, 60 square meter, and for non-metro, 90 square meter, and a capping of 45 lakhs. That is the main decision of the GST Council. And a lot of this discussion is going on. 1 April. First April.
देखिए अफोर्डेबल हाउसिंग के ऊपर हुआ है कि नॉन मेट्रो में 90 स्क्वायर मीटर तक पर 1% लगेगा और जो मेट्रो है शहर है मेट्रो शहर वहाँ 60 स्क्वायर मीटर से ऊपर पर 1% लगेगा, ठीक है ना। उसी प्रकार से 45 लाख रुपए तक जो आरबीआई का गाइडलाइंस है अफोर्डेबल हाउसिंग का, उससे नीचे में 1% लगेगा, उससे ऊपर में होगा तो 5% लगेगा। यही तो डिसाइड हुआ
सर। 1% में इनपुट टैक्स क्रेडिट नहीं मिलेगा तो आप इस
नहीं कोई रिटर्न नहीं मिलेगा, ना 1% पर मिलेगा ना 5% पर।
बिल्डर्स ये कस्टमर्स को पास ऑन करेंगे कि नहीं, ये आप कैसे इंश्योर करेंगे?
अब देखिए कैसे इंश्योर करेंगे ये तो उसके लिए सारी व्यवस्थाएं हैं। बिल्डर आखिर जीएसटी के अभी तक जो हो रहे थे तो बिल्डर्स पास आउट नहीं करेंगे जब हम जाएंगे तो मैं तो 1% टैक्स दूंगा ना। हम यदि खरीदार हैं बायर हैं तो हमको यदि पता है कि भाई 45 लाख रुपए तक यदि हम खरीद रहे हैं फ्लैट को तो हमको 1% लगेगा, 1% हम देंगे उनको। यदि उससे ज़्यादा होगा तो 5% देंगे, जिसमें ITC नहीं मिल रहा है।
और सर लॉटरी पे कोई डिसीजन लिया गया?
लॉटरी पर डिस्कशन अभी चल रहा है।
राइट, those were the key voices both from the government quarter as well as from the industry. The big news then, 5% GST on under construction without input tax credit. This has been cut from 12% where you could get input tax credit, 1% on affordable housing without input tax credit. That's the big breaking news on this Sunday afternoon. A lot of stocks that will be impacted by this across the real estate spectrum that will be in focus in trade tomorrow. Remember, you had slowly and steadily seen a pickup across the real estate space in the last couple of weeks as well, and Friday's trading sessions too, some of these stocks were on the move. We will keep a close eye on the 6 stocks that you're seeing on your screen and much, much more from the real estate space tomorrow. Thanks so much for tuning in on this special edition of Breaking News right here on Business Television India.